So thank you for inviting me. And what I want to share with you today is the work that my colleagues and I have been doing recently in the lab. And to give you a picture of how I conceive of my research project, we're looking at what it is that, how the human mind is built to navigate the social terrain. So if you just think about your world, it looks something like this. And you, of course, have a place in it. OK, so that's a baby since I study babies. And the task that the baby is faced with, or you and I are faced with, more extreme when we move to a new place or start a new job, but even just in our everyday-to-day world, is to figure out, you know, how all of these people relate to each other. What's my relationship to this one, and how do they relate to each other? How do groups of people, you know, how does this whole social terrain group up? Who goes with who, and how do these groups relate to each other, and how do I relate to them? And you and I are constantly having to redraw the social map because things are constantly changing. And babies may be doing some of this too. And what I hope to either convince you of today or at least make you, you know, raise in your head the question that it's a serious possibilities to consider, my view from the work that I've been doing and others as well that we've been finding out over the last 5 and 10 years is that this type of mapping of the social world is what we might call a fundamental mode of construal. It's every bit as primitive and basic a way of looking out and analyzing the world as looking out and seeing where there are objects in the world and what's next to what and what's going to bang into what. We're looking out and evaluating others on the basis of their social traits, their psychological traits, who are they affiliated with, who's on the outs with whom, from very, very, very early in life. And these assessments guide a whole host of our psychological processes, our attitudes, our behaviors towards others, our judgments of those others, and our judgments of, you know, what they deserve. And in these early judgments, we can see both, you know, both sides of the coin of human nature. We can see roots, elements of what give us our system of morality and our ideas of how to make the world a better place. We can also see the roots of the reasons we're trying so hard that we have to try so hard to make the world a better place. We can see the full richness of human nature, I think, from as early as we care to look. So that's what I would like to share with you today. So accordingly, my talk is divided into two halves. We got the moral baby, and then we've got what I call the discriminating baby. So without further ado, so this is my, you know, this just reminded me of a baby wearing one of those judges' wigs of old. So this is the solemn judge looking down, listening gravely to some, you know, moral, event that has gone on and waiting to pronounce judgment. So the first question is, do they in any way judge others by their behavior? And the first study that we ran to ask this question built off of a previous study we had done for other reasons, and we just simply showed babies some characters interacting. And you'll see these are not actual human beings. They're very simplified, pared down characters. We know from lots of other work from other labs that if you have things with eyes, if you have things, creatures that interact with each other in some kind of interactive, reciprocal, contingent manner, and whether we're babies or whether we're adults, these seem to engage in all types of humans, processes of viewing those things as intentional, animate beings socially interacting with each other. So we simply showed babies some interactions and, you know, asked basically, what do they think about these interactions? So you can be asking yourself what you think about these different characters as you see them going along. That's one interaction. And now here comes the second interaction. Again, the character's trying to get up a hill. This time, someone comes along and pushes it down the hill. And so our question was, Our question is, who does baby prefer? Do they have a different attitude towards the one that's pushed him up or the one that's pushed him down? And here is a six-month-old, or from the age of five-month-olds and up, the way we ask, do they have a preference for one character or another is simply, who, you know, offer them both characters and actually give them a choice. Who do they want? Who do they reach for? For babies who are younger than this, we ask, three-month-olds are too young to reach. They're not, they don't have a lot of muscular capabilities, a lot of physical motor control yet. They can, you know, can hold their head up on their own, but they can't sit up on their own, let alone do accurate reaching. So we just hold them out and see who do they orient to in their looking behavior. Who are they more oriented to? And we've, since doing that study, we've presented babies with a variety of different scenarios. So I just wanted to show you them so that you can, you know, be assured that our results don't relate to some idiosyncratic properties of one specific type of scenario or another. So here we have a character who's trying to open a box. And babies are, you're looking at this from the baby's perspective. And one character helps the guy open the box. And here in the next scene, again, there's an attractive toy inside of the box. And so, again, our hero is attempting to open the box. And this other character comes along and is the opposite of helpful, smashes the lid down. And then here in our third scenario, we have an individual who's playing with a ball and rolls the ball to another character. Okay, so we've got a nice reciprocal give and take type of interaction between those two. But what is the green-shirted character going to do? And of course, I should say that for half the babies, you know, the green-shirted puppet is the one who absconds with the ball. We counterbalance all these sort of things, like who's on the left and who's on the right and who's wearing what color of shirt. And who will babies prefer between these different characters? And what we find is it really doesn't matter our scenario or what ages we study. The blue bars in each pair is how many babies, what percentage chose the nice one or oriented towards the positive character, and the red is who chose the negative character. So you can just see the pattern doesn't, you know, is the same at 10 months as it is at 3 months and across our different ages and scenarios. It's the same pattern we get regardless. Babies have a very robust preference to orient towards and interact with the positive character. Some further findings that I'm just going to tell you about and not describe the studies in detail. If you throw neutral characters into the mix, babies prefer a pro-social character to a neutral character, and they prefer a neutral character to an antisocial character. So from very early on, babies are already, you know, both sides, both positive valence and negative valence are being detected. The exception to this is our very youngest age, three-month-olds, they're equally, you know, happy to orient to neutral and positive characters, but they really are avoiding the negative characters. So it looks like negative information may speak more loudly and possibly be developmentally privileged over positive information. This is what we refer to as a negativity bias, and that's consistent with a lot of findings from social psychology on adults as well, showing that negative information, we orient to it more quicker, and it's more salient and speaks louder than positive information. These all our results are specific. Babies' preferences only apply when the events they have witnessed are social interactions. If we replace some of the characters, for example, the character who was trying to climb up the hill, if we replace it with an inanimate ball that is now just being pushed up the hill, you know, by a character who's getting it to the top or someone else pushing it down the hill, babies don't have a preference for the pusher-upper over the pusher-downer, And our other studies likewise have these inanimate controls. It's only, you know, when the thing is inanimate, you no longer can have an interpretation that there's helping going on or hindering, or that it's a social interaction that has a positive or negative valence. When you remove that, the effect goes away. Studies of Kylie Hamlin, who has been involved in a lot of this research. She was a graduate student in my lab and is now an assistant professor at UBC in Vancouver. She has gone on to do some further studies showing that babies' responses are really based on the actor's intentions. An actor who looks like he's really trying to help the character get up to the top of the hill, for example, but who fails, is preferred over an individual who looks like he's trying to interfere but fails at interfering. So it's not which character is associated with success or failure. It's really babies are assessing, what are the intentions of these guys? Are they meaning to be, you know, on a helpful, friendly team with this other person or not? Some studies that are currently going on in my lab, Arbor Tassimi is a graduate student who's currently pursuing this in further ways, really asking the question, how significant are these evaluations in babies' minds? Are they just, you know, this one's a smidgen more better than this one? Or are these really significant and meaningful evaluations? And he's got a couple of ways of asking this question. One way involves asking, how long do babies actually remember these evaluations? So babies, the way he did this, babies are first coming into the lab and seeing our box scenario, where one puppet helps open the box, and the blue-shirted puppy in this photo here is the one who, in a minute, is going to slam the box shut. Then, and they just see this. They don't make a choice right away. They're brought in 1 week later to make the choice. And the question is, can they remember for 1 week to the next that this pale yellow-shirted puppy is, you know, was a nice character, and this pale blue-shirted puppy was a mean character? They're just offered them to choose. What we find is we're in the midst. We've only tested 9 babies so far. 8 of them have chosen the positive, and that's statistically significant, even though it's a small sample size. So it looks like they are really, you know, holding quite a, I mean, I find it surprising, because I watch the things and I explicitly asking myself, I'm like, which one was wearing which color shirt? And I'm terrible at it. We don't know that the babies are explicitly remembering, right? But they're remembering, you know, it looks like they are at an unconscious, you know, level that is nonetheless guiding their ability to be more oriented to one than to another. The other way that Arbor Tassimi is asking this question is he's developed a method to actually start to quantify the extent of babies' preference for one character over another. So how much do babies prefer nice guys? What is, in other words, the cost they're willing to pay in order to avoid interacting with one? So here we have experiment one. First, they're presented with, you know, our helping and our hindering scenario, the box show. And then the two puppets are brought out. But they each offer the baby at the same time a plate with some goodies on it. Well, the helper offers just one little graham cracker on his plate. But the hindering puppet has 2 graham crackers to offer. And they both push them forward, you know, like, here, whose do you want? And here's what we find. We find that these babies are strongly willing to take a cost to avoid interacting with the negative character. They'd rather have the one cracker from the positive guy. And we know from other work on babies' basic numerical abilities from Lisa Feigenson and others, and including some work that Christy herself has done, babies, you know, if you give them a choice between one cracker and 2 crackers, they'll pick the greater number of crackers, all else being equal. So they're going against their baseline instincts in this case. Well, what if you up the cost considerably, all right? Like, can we bribe babies to deal with the devil? This is Arbor's term for this experiment, dealing with the devil. Here, when it's 1 cracker versus 8, all right. So I love this result for a few reasons. One is it shows that, you know, well, first of all, I love this result. It shows that babies, you know, are willing, it matters to babies sufficiently that they're willing to pay a cost in order to avoid interacting with this sketchy dude. But it's not an absolute rule, right? Babies, even at, these were one-year-olds basically, are performing a cost-benefit analysis and deciding their own thresholds. And we're getting right now, this is not a significant preference for one or the other. It's about two-thirds of babies going for the larger at this point. So different babies seem to be having their own different threshold, maybe based on how hungry they are, or possibly more enduring individual differences. And then the final reason I like it is I like to just think that it means that not only are babies willing to pay a cost in order to avoid interacting with a negative character, but that maybe there actually is a cost to being a negative person out in the world, precisely that people want to shun you and you have to come up with extra. You have to try to overcome that in some ways and work to earn people's, get people back to you. And then we were interested in pushing this question a little further. How do babies really, are they just wanting to avoid interacting with these negative characters, or do they really think that they're bad and wrong? We were trying to figure out how could we push the question of whether babies are just making a judgment about who they like and who they don't like, or is there a way in which they're making moral or proto-moral judgments about what type of behavior is acceptable in the world and what's unacceptable. And we thought that maybe asking babies about who deserves what, you know, who's deserving of what types of actions and behaviors in the world, this might be one way to get at that question. So for our first study along these lines, these were actually toddlers, not babies, 18 to 21 months of age. We presented them first with our scene involving a good character and a bad character, and then with a situation where there's treats to be dispensed out. We'd previously helped train them how to dispense these treats into the bowls of different puppy puppets. But now they're in a situation where, there's not enough treats to go around. So I'm going to narrate. I think my sound isn't working. I'm going to narrate what the experimenter says here. First, I'm going to just see if this will do it. But it's not going to do it. So remember these guys from the show? So this person here, right? This experimenter, she doesn't know who's who. She doesn't know which was the nice one and which was the mean one. We're getting them out bowls. Here there's bowls. We're going to give them some treats now. Do you want to help me give them treats? Let's give them some treats. Okay, let's give them some treats. Okay, let's get the treats. Okay, we're getting the treats. Oh no, there's only one treat left. Can you help me decide who to give it to? You can give it to this one here or this guy here. Can you help me decide? Now he's all ready. Okay, doesn't take him any time at all. There we go. What about this little girl? She's in a slightly different condition. Oh no, look what I found. A puppy who didn't get a treat. His bowl is empty. I think we have to take away a treat from one of these guys' bowls and give it to him. We can take a treat from this guy, or we can take a treat from this guy and give it to him. Can you help me decide who to take a treat from? Okay, and again, she has no trouble deciding who to take a treat away from. And what we find is that when they're giving a treat, they give it to the nice guy. When they got to take away a treat from someone, they're taking it away from the mean guy. So we can still ask, do babies actively want that negative character to be punished? Or just if they're forced to punish one of them by taking away a treat, you know, and dispensing some negative behavior towards them, is it the negative character that you know, if I've got to pick somebody to be mean to, it might as well be this one rather than that one? Or do they actively want them to be punished? First of all, some anecdotal information. Every now and then, you know, our toddlers and babies, they have their own responses, not just the ones that we ask of them. So don't blink, because this is very short. But this is So pow. And yes, it was the bad guy that he punched. Every once in a while, a baby will pick up one of the puppets and spontaneously hug it or kiss it. And these anecdotal responses go in just the directions you would expect, right? They're not hitting the nice guy, and they're not hugging and kissing the bad guy. But we wanted to ask more systematically. So we hit on this strategy of asking. We also wanted to ask it of younger babies. So we thought, well, younger babies themselves can't be, they're too young to be dealing with this really complicated giving and taking of treats. But maybe they can make judgments about others in the world behaving in ways that they approve of or disapprove of, or that they think are being, you know, treating others appropriately. So here is how this experiment went. First, babies see one of our interactions, say the ball show, where there's a nice character who returns the ball and engages in this reciprocal interaction, friendly interaction, and a mean character who runs away with the ball. And then for half the babies, let's say it was Green Shirt who stole the ball, for half the babies, it's the negative character who's now in our box show trying to open that box, and somebody helps him and another one hinders him. Who do babies prefer between those two? Do they prefer the one that's nice to the mean guy or the one that's mean to the mean guy? And of course, for the other half of the babies, it's the nice character who's trying to open the box. Who do babies prefer, the one who helps him or the one who hinders him? And when the recipient is the pro-social character, this should be unsurprising. I've just shown you a bunch of other findings where babies preferred the positive individual. 5 months, 8 months, and 19-month-olds all prefer the nice character. It's nice to be nice to a nice guy. When it's the antisocial target, what we find is an interesting switch somewhere between 5 and 8 months of age. The 5-month-olds look like they're still going by what I call the local valence. It's nice to be nice. We like nice. Nice to be helpful. By 8 months of age, they have switched their interpretation and are computing the global valence. Well, you know, we don't approve of someone who aids and abets the purse snatcher, picks them up if they fall over, and hands the purse back to them and helps them on their way, right? That's really not acceptable behavior. Their just desserts are to be treated, you know, to be condemned, not condoned, and aided and abetted. And from 8 months and up, that is what we are finding. Babies prefer the character who treats them badly over the character who treats them nicely. And we, you know, we don't actually know what the reason is for the 5-month-old's local valence, whether they actually are in principle, you know, whether it's a logical limitation that they're not able to compute this, okay, a locally nice act acted upon a negative character means, you know, a plus and a minus, a plus times a minus. It's really mathematics. It's all parity, right? Plus times minus is minus. Maybe they're not capable of doing that logical step. Maybe they really just are capable of doing it but don't make it. It's just always nice to be nice. Or maybe they are having memory difficulties because it's a complicated enough sequence of events that they're not following everything. We don't know. But we can certainly say by 8 months of age, they're making judgments that I would say are along the lines of the judgments you and I would make in the kinds of parallel situations we encounter in our lives. So are these moral responses? Well, they are in the sense that all of the work I just showed you involves babies judging others on the basis of their social behavior. Not only are they judging others, they're judging, making judgments about characters that the babies themselves have not previously interacted with, and those characters aren't acting towards the babies. The babies aren't the recipients of the positive and negative behavior. It's all third-party interactions between strangers, and even though the babies are disinterested bystanders, they're capable of rendering these judgments. And social behavior and, you know, the types of consequences that our behaviors have upon others, that's squarely the domain of moral psychology. So there are moral responses in that sense. And that's just justice is blind in the weak sense, by virtue of being disinterested bystanders and making these impartial judgments. However, these judgments are just one piece of a larger pattern of responses that includes judgments and assessments of others for reasons that you and I would say really are not moral at all, and that many of us would feel quite uncomfortable. You know, many of us are uncomfortable about a lot of the awful judgments that humanity's busy making about others for a variety of reasons in really immoral ways. So this brings me to talk two. And I like this photo for a few reasons, but one of them is just, you know, I hope that the, you know, from the first part of my talk to have convinced you that even in a creature of our species as young as 3 months of age, you know, when you go out in the world and are bump into a baby on the street and it gives you a look like this, I want to tell you, I think it's not just, you know, gas. I think, you know, that it looks like they're evaluating you. I think it is because they are evaluating you. You're under the gun in this situation, and you're on display here, and you've got, you know, your precious thin slice of moment to try to turn things around in this case and make a more positive impression. But they really are, you know, this has to be, right? They weigh 8 pounds. They're the size of a loaf of bread, and there's not very much they can do except for start cooing and being as cute as possible, or turning around and screaming for backup, like, ah, mom and dad. That's why they're really good noise machines in them. That's their, right? They have to be using, you know, these minuscule two tools at their disposal and evaluating the situation to know which to use, because that's really all they have. So they are working really hard to place themselves in the social world and figure out what are the meanings of these different individuals to me. Okay, so we know babies make social preferences on a lot of different dimensions. We know babies sometimes will prefer to look at photographs of some races of face over other races of face. The catch is, this only holds true of babies who are brought up in homogeneous racial environments. If they only see Caucasian faces or they only see black faces, that's the face type of face they prefer to look at. If they're raised in heterogeneous racial environments, I don't mean in their home, I just mean exposure, reasonable amounts of exposure to both races, they do not show a preference for one race or another. So we can say they prefer familiarity. You know, if one's a lot more familiar, they will prefer it. We know babies prefer attractive faces over unattractive, and not just face, not just looking at facial photographs, but they'll prefer interacting with an experimenter who's attractive over one who's plain. And actually, the study didn't bring in like different undergraduates and you. I really need an ugly person to show the face. It was more they had a Hollywood makeup artist make up the experimenter, and she didn't know whether she was being made up from one baby to another to be really attractive or really the very plain. But babies interacted more willingly and more longer and were more happy with the positive face, with the attractive, when she was made up attractively. We know from work by Katie Kinsler and her colleagues at University of Chicago that babies prefer others who speak, I hesitate to say the baby's own language because the babies are not yet speaking, but speak the baby's the native language of the baby's community. And they also, over someone who speaks a foreign language, and they also prefer someone who speaks their native language with a native accent over someone who's speaking their native language, but say with a French accent. So babies are making a variety of early social preferences. You know, they have a lot of ways of deciding, you know, who's more preferable than others. And one other dimension that turns out to be a very important one in psychology is that we like others who are similar to us. And just to point out really quickly, this isn't unique to humans. We're not the only species that likes others who are similar to us. I think our work as psychologists, the findings are still a little cumbersome in this regard. So I'll mention what to me, for some reason, is the most interesting one, which involves fish. I'm not talking about the phenomenon that fish tend to school with their own species. But within a particular species, For some species of fish, within their particular school, different individual fish will have their own fish buddies that they like to hang out with. I'll hang out with you underneath, you know, in this shade underneath the rock at the edge of the stream, and we'll let those other ones that belong to our same, you know, fish group, they hang out with each other. But fish have their individual fish buddies, and at least looking with our human-centric eyes at what we consider salient dimensions of similarity and difference amongst fish, which may or may not be the dimensions that fish, you know, evaluate each other on the basis of. But it looks like the ones that are hanging with each other are more similar in certain respects. You know, their exact size and their particular shading and so on and so forth. The horses phenomena, if you get big enough herds of horses, like retired horses on acres of farmland, there's people have reported sometimes that the similar colored horses like to hang out with each other to greater extents than you would expect by chance. And you can basically, if you would explore the entire animal kingdom, you would find tons and tons and tons of examples where there's a self-assorting on the basis of similarity. We know from social psychology, from work of Tajfel, for the last many decades, that for humans, almost any similarity seems to be sufficient to start generating differential treatment from the minimal groups work. So researchers can bring subjects who don't know each other into the lab and randomly assign them to different groups by asking them to flip a coin, and then there's the head flippers and the tail flippers, or by running through the group and distributing red t-shirts and blue t-shirts, and you know, you happen to get a red t-shirt and you happen to get a blue t-shirt. Any means, subjects know that it's not their control which group they fell into, that it's random, you know, accident of chance, but nonetheless, that influences a host of consequential psychological processes from subjects' preferences, their preference judgments, their perceptions and expectations. Who do they judge to be more likely to, you know, be smarter, nicer, more attractive, and so on? Subjects judge that their other random individual that they don't know and will never meet again, that also happened to get a blue t-shirt just like them, is going to be higher on these dimensions than someone who got a red t-shirt and thus fell into the other category. So my colleagues and I were really interested in the developmental picture of this. How do we come to develop such extreme views about others who are similar to us? And we thought, wouldn't it be really interesting to study this in babies? And we thought long and hard about what dimension of similarity we wanted to look at, because there's a lot of different dimensions along which we can be similar to others or different from others. And the different dimensions might, many of them might really have their own, you know, they might not all be the same. So we started doing this work shortly before the first Obama presidential election, and maybe it was the year, you know, the year in the buildup to that first, the 2008 election, and all the hyperbole from Washington and the, you know, the extreme partisanship and the two camps. At any rate, we landed on the difference of similarity of opinion, having the same belief about something, falling into the same camp on, well, I don't want to say ideological grounds. We're about to be testing, you know, 7 and 11 months of age. But having the same attitudes to the world in some respects as being one really interesting dimension to study, because it's meaningful to humans. It's a dimension over which we sometimes, you know, have control over. It's not always just an accident that we end up in the group that, you know, has this opinion or that. So we thought it would be interesting. And it also is useful, a good dimension, because I really wanted to not have whatever our dimension of similarity was going to be, I didn't want to have it be confounded with familiarity to the baby. Like the language that they hear all the time is the language of their group, but it's also much more familiar to them. I wanted to be asking, you know, are babies making judgments that don't, where familiarity is not an issue? So the way we ran this study is that babies choose between two options. such as between two toys, and then babies are introduced to, so okay, let me just walk you through it. That's the easiest. So here, the researcher is presenting a toy helicopter, which this little girl chooses, and the other was a toy car. That's phase one. She makes a choice between these two objects. Phase two, she sees two puppets. This puppet, who, if you, I may call your attention, is wearing a really dark blue shirt. Ew, I don't like this. Hello, what's this? Ooh, I like this one. Okay, and that happens to be the same one the baby chose. Okay, now pale blue shirt. What's that? Ew, I don't like that. Ooh, what's this? Ooh, I like this. Okay, so that's phase two. And then the baby is just, you know, the toys have been taken away now, and the baby is just given the choice between these two puppets, which one will she choose? And choice is whichever one they actually touch first. It has to be a visually guided touch for all of our studies. The touches can't just be, I'm flailing around looking at things and having to hit. They have to, like, be looking and touch after they have clearly seen both of them. Those are our criteria. So we've done this with toys, with mittens. You know, do you want the yellow mittens or the orange mittens? And we've done both of these with 7-month-olds, and the mittens also with 11-month-olds. And we've also, with 11-month-olds, used food. We've used two foods, one of which babies tend to like more than the other one. And we've also used two foods, both of which we know babies love them all. And here is what we find when it's two foods. It really actually doesn't matter whether they're two foods, baby likes them both or not. Babies robustly prefer the puppet who chose similar to them. When it's other thing, when it's mittens, the same. And when it's toys with 7-month-olds, it's the same. Babies are, you know, and this phenomenon is just as strong with 7-month-olds as it is with 11-month-olds. Babies are preferring the individual who chose similarly to them. So, well, I'm not going to ding baby. I mean, I choose my friends on the basis of that they have some similar interests to me, right? We all do that. That's completely normal aspect of being human, to like others who share views of the world or have some similarities in common. But we can ask, you know, are babies just liking the one that's similar to them? Or, you know, what are their attitudes to the one who's different from them? Are they actually disliking that character in some way? How can we possibly test this? Well, we already have this measure that we developed for these other studies of assessing how do babies think different individuals should be treated? What kind of treatment will they condone versus condemn of different individuals? So we ran exactly that study. Babies choose between two choices. Then they get introduced to two puppets, one of whom makes the same choice as the baby, the other of whom makes the opposite choice. And just in passing, in case you're interested, some babies do choose the green beans. Don't know why. Then one of the puppets comes in, and you know, phase two is our box show. For half the babies, it's the puppet who chose the same of them that's trying to open the box. For the other half of babies, it's the puppet who chose different from them that's trying to open the box. One of the kitties helps, one of the kitties hinders. And so our question is, who do babies prefer? The one who helps the one that's similar to them? Probably, because babies seem to almost always prefer being helpful to being unhelpful. The really interesting condition is, what about the puppet who chose different from them? How will babies respond in this case? When it's the similar recipient, baby chose graham crackers, individual puppet who chose graham crackers is trying to open the box, babies like the helper. When it's the one who chose different from the baby, we get just the opposite effect. Babies actually are every bit as much preferring the character who's mean to that individual. So, you know, I still... I still feel the need to apologize every time I show this slide, like, damn, nasty little bitty things. Like, that's really bad. Don't do that. So let's get rid of that slide since it makes me feel uncomfortable. There we go. All right. So we're not going to treat everybody equal. You know, the ones who are different from us, we're holding a different standard to, at least as it regards difference of opinion. So having started my life as a cognitive scientist, I'm really, you know, there's different ways we could unpack the nature of this early preference. The hypothesis that I believe is the accurate one, and some have some research to support, is that it's really a preference for others who hold a shared value with me. You like what I like, so I like you. You have a different opinion from me and don't like what I like what I don't like, or both, and I don't like you. But, you know, there are other possible interpretations that could also explain the data I've shown you thus far. So alternative one is maybe it's just there's a similarity of circumstance. Look, I was holding a helicopter. Now this one's holding a helicopter. I was wearing orange gloves because the experimenter put them on my hand after I pointed to them and touched them. And maybe that's because I like orange. But nonetheless, the fact might be revolving around I was wearing yellow gloves and you're wearing yellow gloves. There's some, you know, we're in the same position in the world in these respects. The second alternative is, okay, I really do actually like these orange gloves. And you, of course, the puppet happens to have the orange gloves because the puppet chose the orange gloves. But maybe it's just like, well, I really like orange. And look, there you have some orange. So I like you better than you because I like orange better than yellow. So you have what I like, and so I like you better. Or the third one is, well, you like what I have. I chose orange, so I have orange. I'm sitting here with my orange mitts. You went and expressed a liking for orange. Maybe that somehow is viewed as a validation or possibly as a positive sign of social affiliation, right? How many times when we're trying to make friends with somebody and they say something, right? That's a form of social glue. Oh, I like that too. Or you have a red Datsun. I've always really liked red cars. And really the reason you have a red Datsun is because that was the you buy your cars used and that's what the dealer had for the right price or whatever. But you know, someone like, you know, it's nice when people say they like the choices you've made. So it could be any of these. So how do we start to tease amongst these? Is it just similarity of circumstance? It is not just similarity of circumstance. If we remove choice from the equation and just show babies, look, we got all these orange mittens and we got these yellow mittens. Well, I'm going to give you some orange mittens. Here you go. Look, puppets, here's these two puppets. I'm going to give you orange mittens and give you yellow mittens. The effect completely goes away. Now, this is kind of interesting because this is the only condition, the mittens condition, where babies are still actually wearing their mittens and the puppets are still wearing their mittens at the time of choice. If it's the food condition or the toys condition, we take the food and toys out of the way so they're not distracting while babies actually make their choice. So there's a memory component. What did I choose? What did they choose? Do I care about matching them? Here, they actually got the mittens still on their hands, right? And they don't care at all. They are not responding to, you know, perceptual similarity with these puppets or the fact that they both have been placed in a similar circumstance. It looks as if it's really similarity of opinion, or that at least one or the other's choice has to matter somehow. What about the second alternative option, that it's some positive association? You happen to have that which I really like. So the baby, the way we tested this, the baby makes their choice. So the baby's actively choosing a toy or a food was how we did this one. And then the puppets don't get to choose. The puppets are assigned. So one puppet is given the toy the baby chose. The other puppet's given the toy the baby didn't choose. We're still testing, OK? We've tested Three, seven babies, all right? So it's hardly a done deal, but, you know, already four of the seven are choosing the puppet who got the different toy from what the baby chose. So I'm going to go on a slight limb here. What I view in my own head as a thick, sturdy, sound, short limb from which I am comfortable standing and proclaiming to you before I fall to my humiliating, you know, as the next eight babies come in. But what I'm going to say, it doesn't look like babies care that someone else happens to have what the baby themselves like. Okay, what about the final alternative? This notion that, okay, well, I happen to have my, you know, little red dots in here, and you chose it and sort of validated my state of being and by expressing a positive attitude towards it. Now, there we are, done testing, and babies really don't care at all if they have been assigned some object. They don't make a difference between the puppet that chooses that and expresses a dislike for the other, or the puppet that expresses a dislike for what the baby was given and chooses the other. I think I said that right. So I think it really is about, fundamentally, a notion of a shared opinion. I have a certain stance to the world. You have expressed the same stance to the world. You have expressed a contrasting stance to the world. This is a fundamental trait along which we affiliate with others. And this is a fundamental trait along which we mark that there is a distance between ourselves and others. One last final piece of evidence for this is that if we make it really not salient to babies what their own preference is, the effect goes away. How do you make it not salient to babies what their own preference is? Well, babies are little creatures of limited cognitive resources and memories and stuff. This is how our standard task goes, right? Baby makes their choice, puppets then make their choices, and then baby choose puppet. What we did to decrease babies' salience of their own preference in the matter was we simply we reordered these three things and put the baby's choice down at the end. So presumably if the baby actually has a preference between graham crackers and green beans or whatever it is, that preference is gonna not have changed spontaneously in the middle of the study. It doesn't really matter when we test it. But if we put it at the end, the babies haven't been, you know, it's not as salient to them. If it's at the beginning, they just had to make a choice. They've just been reminded what their own choice is. Then they see the puppets, and that makes the comparison of self to other really easy when it comes time to choose between the two puppets. If we've moved it down here, that makes that comparison much more difficult. And the effect completely goes away when we remove babies, the ease, when we make it so much more difficult for babies to compare what preference they might have with the preference the puppets just expressed. So I think what's really going on, even 7 months of age is the youngest we've tested. This was with 11-month-olds, but I think this fundamental finding that we are finding of preferring others who are expressing the same taste as the baby is really a consequence of even 7-month-old babies looking out in the world and making these cognitive comparisons to self and preferring when those comparisons come up with a similarity and over when they're different. So just, you know, it's an interesting question. Why would we be built to prefer others who have the same tastes as us? Why are we finding this in babies so young, suggesting that it may be a fundamental feature of human psychology? I think there's a lot of reasons why it might be adaptive and useful to have these preferences and therefore, you know, to have had them selected for over the last, you know, many millennia of human evolutionary history. So one is if you have similar interests with others or the same tastes as others, if you're going out, you know, you can, if you prefer whatever, a certain type of berries over a different type of food, right? There's certain types of knowledge and skills that you can share with others who share your own interests and pursuits and have your similar agendas. There's common ways of getting, achieving those desires that may be different from if you have different tastes. It allows for cooperating together towards common goals. Okay, we all like strawberries. Let's go look for the strawberries and work together to find them and get them. If you like coconuts and I like strawberries, that we're gonna, you know, that those require totally different different strategies. If I'm off, you know, going doing following my pursuits and you're following yours and they're the same, it's just, you know, you're likely to. We like company. We're a very social species, and we like to have company. And being drawn to others who have common interests to us means that we're probably going to bump into them more frequently, and they're going to, we might as well like them for those reasons. We're going to be spending more time with them. And then, like I said, we started these studies during a political year, and then by the time we got to the end of them, we were in the middle of another election year, and. You know, I tend to sometimes look at these infant results and think, well, maybe we're looking at the earliest special interest groups being formed, right? If you've got, we've always been a social species. We've always had, you know, competing agendas within our social structures and, you know, social individuals having to duke it out socially, not always with our fists. And getting together with those who share your interests, you gain critical mass, and it's politically very, you know, useful. So there's a lot of reasons we would be built, that it could be useful for us to be built to prefer others who share our own opinions. Okay, but now we live in an increasingly globalized world. We're interacting through economic commerce, through all kinds of manners, with individuals on many other countries than us, of different ethnicities, of different religions, of different races, of different belief systems, and different, you know, and we want to actually get along with everybody, and we wish they would all get along with each other, right? Like, stop making it all so unpleasant. when we turn on the 5 o'clock news, can't you all, you know, smarten up? So we want, you know, it's no longer functional and beneficial to, and it may always be functional and beneficial to prefer others with the same viewpoints as us. That just may be the way the world is always going to work. But it's no longer beneficial to have gut-level responses of, I dislike you, you're on the other, I mean, shall I point my finger at Capitol Hill once again? That is not a good example of functionality and efficiency and a model of how's the world going to actually work smoothly these days by just completely dissing the other and wishing poo to rain down upon their heads because they have different views from ourselves. It's not working. It's a waste of time and resources, and it's making us all grumpy. Speaking for all of you, I'm just going to stand up here and say it's making us all grumpy, making me grumpy. So can study, you know, I've been studying babies. Is there any way that studying babies and what we're learning from the infant picture that this could possibly be helpful in figuring out how to help people get along better in the world? Now, I don't have any type of answer to the question for how to help people get along better in the world. Sorry, I don't have any answer to that. But I do think there is some potential for developmental studies to speak to this question. So what we know from other domains of infant cognition, like numerical knowledge that Christy is studying, or naive understanding of physics, of the physical world, and so on, we know that when we find systems of core understanding, we know these systems don't get erased with development. You don't change out one notion of number for a totally different one and completely lose the initial. You don't change out your naive views of how physical bodies interact. Once you go and major in physics and become a physics professor, you don't forget all of that and no longer hold it and now hold more sophisticated physics beliefs. You develop new beliefs on top of the core. The core structures form foundations for future learning, and the information that comes in can either fit with the core, in which case it is held better and you know, more easily gloms onto the skeletal structures and is built upon, or it doesn't fit well with the core, like trying to teach a little kid that thinks numbers are what you get when you count, basically the positive integers, trying to teach that kid fractions or negative numbers or something. And we know that input interacts with core cognition, and that if you can structure whatever the incoming new knowledge is, that if it's structured in the right way so that it can fit somehow with the core or take advantage of what the core foundation is, you can get a much better purchase and foothold on it. Whatever the input messages that are coming in, they're going to be influenced by that core cognition that's underlying. So if we have a core cognition that says that privileges similarities and, you know, devalues difference, I think that raises, you know, the possibility for some interesting questions to be asked. So for example, my own two children who are now in their teenage years, when they were in primary school, they went to this private school in New Haven, and the private schools in New Haven all are really concerned with diversity, with appreciation of diversity and tolerance, and with cultivating respectful communities in their schools. But there could be different ways of going about trying to give those messages. And the schools that my kids were in anyways, and what I heard of my kids' friends that were in other schools, there was a lot of talk of, well, let's look how they celebrate New Year's over here in this culture. Let's look how they celebrate New Year's over here in this culture. Look at all the beautiful different ways that we have to do this. But there may be really different effects of highlighting all the differences of humans from, say, highlighting how we really are all similar. If we're speaking to creatures with a core system that disvalues diversity or disvalues difference and values similarity, these might be really different kinds of messages, and you might, you know, this might be effective. I don't know. I haven't yet. This is one area I'm interested in going next in my research, is actually asking these questions empirically. But it might be that something like this is, at best, bumping your head against a brick wall, and at worst, actually helping to foster the very things you're hoping not to. These might be really different kinds of, have different type, you know, levels of efficacy. So thank you all for listening, and let me just acknowledge all my many collaborators. And is, what could be going on with our hill scenario? Babies at the ages we're testing them are two, you know, we even tested 3-month-olds in that. They're not self-mobile at all. They themselves haven't had experience trying to get from location A to location B and having to be prevented by a parent or anybody or being helped because they have no self-locomotion. I think more and more research is showing us that babies are, from early ages, are able to look out and observe actions of other individuals in their world and evaluate, you know, be able to see in an action, this person is attempting to achieve goal state X or Y, or they're attempting to achieve this or that, or they're attempting to get from here to there. Look, this one's chasing that one. Look, this one's running away from that one. At ages where babies aren't doing those particular types of actions themselves. So we know, and that's not even particularly research from my own lab. Most of that research is from other labs. But the picture is pretty clear that babies are built with the apparatus to do a read of, you know, when they're see an action, what this, you know, if it's a reasonably transparent action, right? They're not going to be reading, oh, you're putting money in the bank, you're saving for college, right? But this creature is facing its eyes up the hill, it's moving up, it's slipping back. We tried to give it psychophysical cues that it's trying, this sense of it slowing down, slips back. And babies have the apparatus to be able to extract some of the intentions from an action. So that's all I can tell you. They seem to be doing it. Otherwise, we wouldn't be finding significant effects in our studies. Yes, and then.
So you're finding that the baby's feeling that this other character made a choice makes them prefer that choosing. And you were citing social psych research, minimal groups research, where there it's not about the choice. Like you're born into your race, or you were randomly handed the red T-shirt or the blue T-shirt. So it's not choice that matters for these adults. What happens? How do you reconcile it?
So the question is, are we seeing something, you know, adults look like they're showing an even stronger bias towards minimal groups where there clearly wasn't a choice in being handed a red T-shirt or a blue T-shirt, but they're showing a preference and our babies aren't. And I think, you know, it is a real possibility that we may actually start with this basic tendency and then have, by experience and enculturation, that becomes even stronger as we become exposed to all the particular groups around us and just see what the social consequences are of these different meaningful groups. We're surrounded by us on all sides of where these things matter or where even if they don't matter, they matter to people who make big deals out of things like what sports group you cheer for versus what I cheer for and so on. So one real possibility is that they actually, that extremity that we see in adults is fed by enculturation. Another possibility, do I have another possibility in here?
Mm-hmm. Where adults apparently have this tendency to just assume that this personality disposition corresponds to random characteristics of individuals. Maybe babies don't do that.
Right, okay, so the fundamental attribution error. So maybe adults are, even though you were randomly handed the blue T-shirt, just making an assumption that somehow reflects something about you, and maybe babies don't have fundamental attribution error yet. Yeah, I don't think anyone's run developmental studies on when that emerges, so maybe, yeah. Yes?
A question about the salience study. Do you think there's any chance that instead of the study seems, as best I understand it, runs assumption that it's based on some sort of underlying preference that the baby already has that the baby is just not clear about. Is there any chance it could instead be about sort of behavioral action or mimicry that's actually determining the baby's preference?
Mm-hmm. So the baby makes a choice, and so the question is,
if that's not clear, what is it possible that what the baby cares about is that you did the same thing I did, not you have the
same. Right. So is it possible that what the baby cares about is you did the same thing I did, not you have the same preferences I? So there's two versions of that, and one of them we are about to start testing soon. And that one is it important that you agreed with me? You expressed agreement with me. So I just made a choice, even though sometimes it's in a different room and the puppets weren't present, but you know, babies maybe aren't keeping track of everything. I just made this choice, and now you're making the same choice, so you're agreeing with me, or you're making a different choice and disagreeing. And we can test that one by simply reversing the order of those two. Right? The puppets choose first and show their preference. Then the baby chooses between the two toys. So the puppets can't be disagreeing with the baby since the baby hasn't made a choice. But then the baby still has their own choice they just made and the puppets before they choose the puppets. So some really preliminary data suggests that is not going to be the answer either, that we're going to still get the effect, basically. Then the other version is, well, maybe you did the same as me is just the same as I did the same as you. We both did the same thing. We both did the same action. And that is another alternative possibility that I will have to think about how we would test that. I have not thought of that one yet. Thank you. Yes?
So the experimenters are blinded to the choice. Baby, what about the parents that are holding?
They are asked to close their eyes during the instance. Parents, keep their eyes closed. Mm-hmm.
So you found that unsuccessful helpers were preferred to successful hinderers, showing that it was helping, not success, driving preference. Have you ever compared a preference for a successful helper to an unsuccessful helper?
So those were Kylie Hamlin's independent studies she did after leaving my lab, showing that it seems to be based really on intent. Someone who makes an unsuccessful attempt to help is preferred over someone who makes an unsuccessful attempt to hinder. So I tried to help you, I failed to help you, and you never made it up the hill. You're still sitting at the bottom. Babies still prefer that individual over someone who tried to push you down, but you made it up to the top. I don't think she has gone beyond those findings yet to run additional versions like the one you just suggested. But she may be working on it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In traditional societies, kinship is a really important characteristic of the social manner. You started your talk with all those little yellow smiley faces.
Right.
I think from the perspective of an infant, those aren't monomorphic faces. The real world is composed of kin that they have been very good at identifying and distinguishing what the relationships are there. So when we use these more ambiguous characters, it's not quite fitting into that evolved psychology of the infant first sorting in social world. And I wonder with some of these experiments, if instead of using arbitrary, if you instead were using real sort of kin markers.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give you an example. I noticed a child in the village that I studied once playing with a new object that I had. The child's slightly older cousin, we're talking about 12 and 14 months here. The 14 month came over and hit the object after the first child had been playing with it. Subsequently, the 12-month-old hit the object. So
uh-huh.
And I don't think it was really imitation. My take on it was, my kin treats this object this way, therefore I should be treating it that way. I don't have the opposite of a non-kin
right.
doing to see if you would then not imitate or anti-imitate. But that was my intuition, though, really about kinship.
Yeah.
And I wonder if you could plug some kinship things into some of these.
So there's so the question is, what about the role of kinship, and do babies reason differently or think differently or specially about their own kin or about individuals interacting who have markers of being kin to each other? It's a great question. We have some work that we're doing that I'm not don't really have results yet, but that a postdoc in my lab is doing, looking at babies' judgments of, so the marker of kin, again, it's stuffed animals. Just, we use stuffed animals because you don't have to have emotional, you don't either have to have control for emotional expression to make sure it's not just they like the thing that was, you know, you help somebody up a hill and then they put a happy face on and then you like the person that helped, not because of the helping, because of happy, you know, or give them all neutral expressions and then it looks really unnatural. Like it's horrifically unnatural to have positive and negative social interactions with neutral faces. It totally kills the effect. So we use these puppets. So the marker of kinship in this study that my postdoc Dave Petrzewski is doing is they're stuffed monkeys. There's a big stuffed monkey and two little stuffed monkeys that are dark, you know, they're different colors. There's a family of this color brown, and then there's a family of like beige. And the mother, so it's like a mom monkey and her two sons, and a different mom monkey and her children, sorry. I don't think we're specifying sons or daughters. And so do babies expect that the mom monkey with a banana is going to give to her own child or a different child? And stay tuned is all I can say there. But it's a great question. And I've also been really interested in like the next step of asking how malleable are some of these judgments once they're initially formed, and can social affiliation information switch them? So, okay, you're a big jerk because you just pushed so-and-so down the hill or slammed the box. But look, my mom's giving you a big hug. She really likes you. Like, oh, right. And I am sure, like, I'll bet you money. I haven't tested a single baby, but I'm going to bet you $20 that's going to just, that would make a big difference. Yes. Not in these. I'm trying to just think what have apes been tested in. Mostly the kinds of things that are similar. Apes also can tell someone who's intending to be nice but fails from someone who's intentionally. So there's like intentionally trying to give you a treat, but I keep dropping it. I'm just a big klutz. Versus, here, have a treat. Oh, I'm going to pull it away, and teasing. And they can certainly tell that they get fed up way sooner with the tease person. They're like, you know, ape language of thought version of screw you, I'm going to go sulk over here and not, you know, you're bugging me. It's most of the studies have been with human experimenters and not with puppets and things like that. So they the same exact questions have not been asked, but yeah. So no, the short answer is no, people haven't run apes yet on these same exact types of studies.
Yeah, I think it was going back to the first studies where you're looking at the antisocial and the prosocial puppets and infants' preference for them. I think it was 80 or 85% of the babies preferred the prosocial puppet. And I'm thinking about, like, well, what about the ones that prefer the antisocial puppet? And I know that this field is not known for looking at individual differences or following these people up longitudinally. But what about, I mean, are these kids more likely to be antisocial in childhood later on? I mean, does that matter?
So it's a great question. What about the 15% or so of babies that choose the antisocial character in our studies? And we don't yet have measures of individual, you know, is there stability of choice if you gave a baby several, the test-retest reliability. I can say generally, you know, probably 85% is about ceiling of performance that you could ever expect from babies of this age. But I'm just have started a collaboration with Linda Mays in the medical school at Yale, at the Yale Child Study Center, that I'm really interested to see. She's interested in parenting behaviors, and particularly parenting cognitive mechanisms and brain mechanisms supporting parenting under chronic high stress. So she's bringing into her lab mothers and babies and toddlers that just live in the worst areas of New Haven, have horrific, I mean, just hair-curdling, high stress, shootouts happening on their street. there may be no father in the home. The mother may have never asked to be pregnant. She may not want to be a mother. She may or may not love her baby desperately. Maybe, maybe not. There may be domestic violence in the home. And this has the potential to address some really interesting questions about the way I view my results. I still do, is that I'm getting at, you know, fundamental value systems that's in place already. But this will ask, you know, this will put that a little to the test. Is that a fundamental, do we start out, no matter our circumstance, are we starting at the same place? And then as these kids get a little older in infancy and toddlerhood, are we going the same direction or diverging? What are the environmental influences, if any, on these types of social preference? So I got no answers for you, but it's an interesting and important question about.
Just a valid question.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One more question?
Humans, are they wired with this ability to distinguish, or is this something they learn in the early couple of months? For example, when they try to climb to a couch, their mother pushed them a little bit, or when they want to do something, their mother has to do their head.
Right. Well, we can't. So the question is, could these responses and preferences be learned in the first few months of life? We can't preclude that they are in some way that we don't know contingent upon learning, because we know learning starts even in utero. I certainly would be the last person to claim babies aren't sponges learning a whole lot really fast with every waking minute. And actually, other people's studies right now are showing babies learn things even while they're sleeping. But you know, we're finding some of our findings in babies as young as 3 months of age. Those babies are not trying to climb on the couch. They're not trying to reach for things yet. They, you know, many of them haven't learned how to roll over yet. They're you put them somewhere. It's still that nice, comfy position of being a new parent where you can put your baby somewhere and turn away for a moment, and they're still going to, you know, be there when you turn around. And they're going to still most likely still be on their back if that's how you put them. So they're not getting helped. You know, it's not that they're extracting on the basis of personal experience, trying to get things out of boxes or trying to climb up hills and things like that. We know that. But whether there could be some type of observations. I mean, if they were observing others, their mother helped their older toddler, what's to tell them that it's good when their mother gets the toddler to the top of the hill when he was trying and bad when he doesn't, right? Like, what's to give them that fundamental, why put the positive valence on the helping and the negative valence on the hindering and not the other way around, right? I think it's just a fundamental, my view is it's just fundamental to see there's cooperative joint activity toward a common goal. That's a, you know, again, sharing a value system with each other. And that's a feel-good thing when we see it. I think that's what's going on. So thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you.